You're listening to Trading Places. This show is supported by Silverbird, the first digital bank for international trade. Silverbird provides European and UK business accounts for exporters from over 100 countries, giving them access to fast and easy cross-border payments with multiple currencies. Once upon a time, if you wanted a nice bottle of red to close out a hard day in the fields, it would have come from a nearby winery. Even as late as the 1970s, barely a tenth of all wine made was exported. Fast forward 40 years and the global wine trade is such a booming industry, a third of all wine is made in a different country to the one where it's being quaffed. The powerhouses are, of course, Italy, France and Spain, in that order, which account for 52% of all wine exported in the world. The Old World, as it's called, has wine houses that go back a millennia. One house in the Loire Valley in France, the Château du Gaulain, claims a family-owned lineage to this day from the year 1000, broken only by a century of Dutch ownership in the 1700s. But fans of the movie Sideways and of New Zealand Sauvignon Blanc or Argentinian Malbec will be only too aware that the New World has been gaining, returning the industry to its ancient roots when wine was a commodity shipped across the known world. Even the Romans were partial to a French red.
The first wine traders were Phoenicians, then of course ancient Greeks and Romans, and we even know that in Roman times there was some wine imports and exports from the colonies in Spain, from the colonies in future France, from the colonies in the north of Africa.
This is Ilya Kirillin, a wine journalist and tech entrepreneur. Yes, even wine has tech startups these days. They include everything from AI sommeliers who choose your wine via algorithm to devices that record the temperature, humidity, and even the location, horizontal and geographic, of the bottle. Ilya says trade has always been important for wine because this is how grapes and wine knowledge spread around the Mediterranean. Ilya, how has trade shaped the wine industry as we know it today?
If we talk about Bordeaux in France, if we talk about Champagne, if we talk about Cher region, Jerez, they all were developed just because the wine was traded to the markets which could not grow the wine because the weather did not allow them to make wine. And this market was mostly United Kingdom or England, Belgium, some kingdoms in Germany and Nordic countries. So if you look at Jerez or Sherry, right now, you will see even the name of Sherry is going to be in English, in French and in Spanish. Because the traders from England, from France, they would come there, they would make the trading company. And interestingly, even the style of the wines, the way it was made for different markets.
Intriguingly, port wine from Portugal became one of the most famous examples of trade given by the father of modern economics, Adam Smith. Smith said if Portugal is better at making wine than England, and England better at making cloth, they can specialise and create a mutually beneficial trade relationship. And that is precisely what they did, spurred along by the Spanish Wars of Succession in the early 1700s.
Spain actually was one of the biggest exporters to England, but then they had a war, and that's actually how port wine industry started, because English were like, okay, fine, we like Spanish wines, but we cannot buy them. So we need to find a solution. And they looked at Portugal and they had an alliance with Portugal. So they started to buy wines. And if you go now, for example, to Douro region and Oporto, the city, you will still see the English names like Symington family, Grahams.
With those markets, fueled by demand from countries that couldn't make their own wine, came language to describe famous wine regions. Terra, for example, simply describes how the local soil, climate, historical conditions, and the human element mold a wine. So I asked Ilya, what do experts mean by Old World and New World?
Old World countries, France, Italy, Spain, Germany, Austria, Greece, Romania, Hungary, so all the countries around the Mediterranean, as well as, for example, Israel, Lebanon, even Russia, we still consider them to be an old world. New world countries, United States, Mexico, Argentina, Chile, Uruguay, South Africa, New Zealand, and Australia.
Where the old world wines were characterized by having a lighter body, lower alcohol, high acidity, and less fruity flavors, new world wines have tended towards having a fuller body, higher alcohol, lower acidity, and pronounced fruit flavors. Although as new world wines mature, such as Australian Chardonnay and Shiraz, they have embraced more subtlety. Trade created the modern wine regions, styles, and consumption. It is why champagne can only come from the Champagne region in France, why bulk wine sales are an early innovation from Bordeaux, and why London has Canary Wharf. It's even why Spain lifted its game after joining the EU.
So the trade actually formed the wine regions and the wine markets. And without a good market, you will not have a wine region itself. Now, some people say that bulk wine sales is really new. Bulk wine is the sales of non-bottled wines. And Australia and New Zealand are quite big with that. And people say that, well, it's really new for the 21st century. Is it good or bad? But actually, that's the way it was all done before. So the wine was sold in barrels, and then it would come to London or to any other city, and the merchant will bottle the wine, it will put his label, it will put the Chateau and bottled by Barry Brook, for example. If you look at London, for example, this Canary Wharf area, it was where all the wines from Canary Islands were shipped. And we can see the example of the merchants in London that have been doing this for 150, 200 years. And then after Spain joined European Union, of course, they saw the competition. They kind of opened the market. They tried French wines. I was like, oh, I guess we are not at the same level of quality, but quantity is there. So they started to invest a lot to rethink the industry. And right now, in terms of price-quality ratio in the old world, Spain is number one, definitely the same as Portugal, countries like Hungary, maybe Romania. These little-known countries for now, they are really getting there.
Sometimes trade was the only way for old world wines to survive at all. In the 19th century, a North American aphid called Phylloxera decimated French vineyards. French winemakers fled to the Rioja region in Spain, investing significant capital and expertise in order to meet their contracts with insatiable British, Belgian, and Dutch wine drinkers. If empires and ancient traders spread the word of wine in the millennia before the Christian era, colonization did the same for the New World. England provided its colonies, New Zealand, and Australia with a ready market for wine, as did the Dutch in South Africa. But the Spanish and Portuguese had other motives in the Americas.
First of all, for example, if we talk about colonies in South America and Central America, it was for religious purposes because they were Catholics. If you talk about South Africa, interestingly, it was because the Dutch, they always wanted to try to make wine, but they could not because of the climate. So when they arrived to this South of Africa, they were really happy because, you know, there is a sun, the weather is really good. So they tried and they did not succeed very much. And interestingly, we have one of the oldest letters from Amsterdam to the colonies in the Cape saying, sorry, never send your wines again to us. It's not as good as we like to drink, because they liked really good quality wines already.
Was it easier for some colonies than others to make it in the wine game?
If you are a South American ex-colony, just recently become independent, what's your export market? Spain? Spain has enough vineyards. But for Australia, New Zealand, and South Africa, it was much easier to get there. Because from day one, you already have your market.
New Zealand, of course, is very famous for its Sauvignon Blanc. It's from a grape variety that has its roots in France, where historically it's been used to make cheap and easygoing wines. Something for quaffing when you've already drunk the nice stuff. But in the early 1970s, New Zealand began building an industry for the style of Sauvignon Blanc from scratch. Ilya, what was the reaction of the old world when New Zealand Savs emerged on the global scene?
If you read the books from 80s and 90s of these major English critics, which are quite astonishing, because if you think 30 years ago, the Sauvignon Blanc didn't exist. For them, Kiwis, they pushed a lot and they spent lots of money in research, especially in Marlborough region. They really found a way how to make this specific style of Sauvignon Blanc, which is really bright, it has a little bit herbal, really citrusy, so aromatic. It's one of the most aromatic grape varieties ever. So they found out what kind of molecules are giving these herbal aromas, or the citrusy aromas, or these tropical fruit aromas. So right now, it gets a little bit industrial with some producers. They can make different styles of Sauvignon Blanc because of they know how to grow it and they know which yeast to use to get this result. The majority of the wine actually is picked by machines in Marlborough. That's why it can be so well organized and well produced. And it's actually quite amazing because if you see an average price of Sauvignon Blanc from Marlborough, it's quite high, but then the cost is not very high because everything is made by machines. Then it's fermented in huge tanks. Then you don't need aging. You don't need barrels. You don't need much things. So it's quite a good business model, I would say. And the industry is booming. The Marlborough, I think it's like one of the most successful stories in the recent 30 years in the whole industry of wine.
At the moment, we grow, obviously, Sauvignon Blanc, which is our bread and butter. We also have a vineyard in central Otago growing where we grow Pinot Noir. We grow Pinot Gris. We grow Riesling. We have about 3 hectares of Chardonnay, and we're just putting in 2.7 hectares of Chenin Blanc as we speak.
This is Erica Crawford, who co-founded the global Kim Crawford wine brand and now runs Lovelock Wines New Zealand in Marlborough.
New Zealand's probably one of our smallest markets. We started out going to the US because it's a scale issue. It's also a market that I know really well. We work with an Italian family, an importation family, so that we launched there in the beginning of 2014. Now we sell to not only the US, but also Canada, the UK, Belgium, Russia, Iceland, Sweden. Those two in very small proportions also do Korea, Japan, Hong Kong. So lots of little bits to those little markets.
Kim Crawford was a massive brand when you sold it in 2003. What was it like coming back a decade later, trying to sell a wine from a small, unknown label?
Well, firstly, getting to that whole route to market, it's definitely harder than it was, you know, 25 years ago when we started King Crawford, when New Zealand was so new and so novel. Now the market's really crowded with New Zealand brands. So that is quite difficult. And of course, selecting the right partner is of utmost importance to the success of a brand, you know, and I've made mistakes and I've made some fantastic partnerships, so it can go either way. But that, I think, is a crucial factor in success. The channels that we're in this time is, of course, completely different as well to the last few years at Kim Crawford. But the big companies typically have more brands. So when they go to a big buyer like Walmart or whatever they want to go into, they have a strong offering. And they obviously have more money to do the programming as well. If you're small, your channels are a lot more limited, you know, and you tend to go to independents. Because remember, it's not something we need. It's not like toilet paper or bread or butter. It's something we want. And you'd buy something you want from the brand that you like or a philosophy or the people that you get on well with rather than from someone you perhaps don't have such an affinity for.
That's because in many ways, wine is a status symbol, a sign of the kind of life we aspire to have. And French wine is the epitome of this aspiration. For New World wines, this means starting at the bottom and working up the value chain over decades.
And of course, you cannot compete with top wines from France from the day one. So you need to go to supermarkets, and the supermarkets are going to put you on the lowest chain because why? You are new, you are, for example, the wines from Uruguay. They are really amazing, good quality, but they have no name yet. It should be cheaper than Argentinian wine. Why? Because Argentina is well-known, Uruguay is not well-known yet. So you really start with low margin in supermarkets, and you slowly and slowly go up, like Chile did. And Chile, I think, is a really good example of a country that took trade seriously. It was stable in the last 30 years, and it was importing, exporting a lot. And right now, Chilean wine, it's not a matter of quality or of quantity, but everybody knows it.
Consumerism has also created innovations that have changed the industry. Australia, for example, didn't start as a nation of wine drinkers. It was only an exporter. Then in the 1960s, the government began to campaign for its people to start drinking wine. But first, Australians had to figure out how to get it out of the bottle.
And you can see all these advertisements on TV with families. They're like, and I'm going to drink a bottle of wine. This is how you open a wine. So they were showing like really basic things, how you drink wine, how you open a bottle. They developed the screw cap, which is a really fantastic way to serve the wine because you don't have problems with cork. The same about bag-in-box. It was also developed for Australian market because it was, you know, you go for a picnic, you need more wine, but less bottles. So why not put it in a plastic bag? So many things were developed just because The consumers didn't know how to drink it, how to enjoy it, and the industry, the trade, they were kind of, well, let's find a solution for that. In the last 10, 20, 30 years, the technological part of making wine and viticulture, which is even more important, it got to the level when it's now it's really hard to make a bad wine. So you need to be really a bad winemaker if you make completely disgusting wine.
It's not news that if you tell a drinker they're sipping an expensive wine, they'll think it's a better drop, and vice versa. That kind of storytelling can move markets. In 2004, US wine critic Robert Parker predicted the ascendancy of the French grape Malbec, and since then there has been a boom in Argentina. The Italians figured out that if they could tell a good story about Prosecco and make it a bit sweeter than champagne, they'd have a star. But there is likely to be a limit to how much consumers can afford to pay. New Zealand might be running into this problem. Marlborough can't keep up with demand for its Sauvignon Blancs, and prices are rising. Just as competitors from Chile and South Africa step in with cheaper versions.
Wine consumption or trends is just a bell curve, isn't it? So the bulk of the drinkers are still going to go for the bigger brands that are on grocery shelf, because especially Australia, New Zealand, UK, people buy wine from grocery. And then it's the two standard deviations on either side. And it's usually smaller companies that will change style, that will force new methodologies or the natural wine trend, for instance. People are prepared to pay more for an organic apple that looks gnarly, but people are not prepared to pay more for a bottle of organic wine. It is changing, but it's taking a long time. It's really exploded in the last 3 years.
If small wineries lead innovation, do unique challenges also come with that size?
I think that size and scale, there's good, bad, and ugly to everything. When one is of a certain size, obviously access to a whole lot of services is easier. When one is bigger, one has better access to supply. And also at the moment, shipping is a big problem because now we're a little guy and we just don't have shipping clout. So we have to wait our turn. And the big guys have international shipping clout, so they get the free passage. There is some benefit to being big, for sure. The benefit of being smaller is that this time we're an estate proposition, so we only use our own grapes, which means that we control viticulture, especially, you know, being largely organic, depending also what you want to sell. You know, if, for instance, you're very niche, it's like we do now, it is quite a different proposition than going to big buyers. But yeah, they definitely have better buying clout, they have better access.
Small winemakers and sellers also face higher costs as a proportion of their business, and less willingness from financiers to help them bear those costs. While the EU covers 50% of export expenses to markets outside the region, banks aren't willing to lend to risky agricultural enterprises without evidence of sales. Ilya says the costs of travel, sending samples, lab testing, promotions, and of course providing free tastings for many years mount up quickly.
So many little extra costs come in there. But the most important thing, you need to really be aware of the final price. Wine producers look at the competitors and they want to be, for example, 10% premium from competitor number one or 10% lower from competitor number two. So the final price point is quite important. And of course, then when you talk with a buyer, they will want to get the lower export price and they will try to negotiate and buy maybe more, but for the less price.
How does being large or small affect how businesses go about making or selling wine?
The small wine businesses and big wine businesses are completely different industries. The big companies like Gallo, which is the biggest wine producer in the world, Yellowtail in Australia, some companies in France, they operate almost on an industrial level. These industrial wineries, they operate like any FMCG. They need the fastest route to the market. They need supermarket chains. They need campaigns on TV. The marketing department is bigger than the actual production department. And working in the winery over there, it's you just sit next to a computer and you control the temperature of huge tanks and you just give the customer what it wants to get. And it should be average quality, it should be quite okay. It should be a little bit sweeter because average consumer likes a little bit sweeter. And then when the wine is not as good as you expect it to be, if you are small, you don't have money to buy. So you can use only your own. And it's quite a risk. And you cannot add 20% to the price, because nobody would buy it. If you're making it in Europe, it's really expensive to hire people. That's why the wines from South America, for example, they're more competitive in terms of the price, because they don't spend that much money on the workers, which is, unfortunately, same is happening in California, and the same problem is in South Africa.
Is it harder to sell wine if you're smaller?
They say the hardest part is to sell your wine, because there are thousands of wineries from your region. So you need to be different from them, and then you go to a big market and you have to explain yourself. What is happening now is we have a little bit of revolutionary movement of small merchants and small independent wine shops and wine bars that they don't want to work with already big established brands. So you need to have a good alliance with a sommelier or with the people working in a shop or in a distributor, so they will push your wines.
The pandemic made selling wine even more difficult, particularly for small producers which don't sell through supermarkets and faced a 2021 harvest with unsold 2020 vintages still in their tanks.
In terms of shipping and logistics, I can probably just summarise it in one word at the moment. It is nightmare, especially for Australia and New Zealand, where the ships are seemingly passing us by. You ship nothing for 4 months and then everything at once. And so it's really difficult to plan your production schedules. And of course, then when it gets to the other side, especially North America, there's no truck drivers to take it to warehouses. And once it is in the warehouse, there are not enough courier drivers to take it to the accounts. Pre-COVID, we had very, very little trouble. The logistics was smooth and happened relatively fast. In New Zealand then, you know, you'd load things on a ship, but it took 2 weeks to leave New Zealand. Now, we started noticing this round about December last year, and it really ramped up from about February, March. We had a small shipment going to Australia. I think it was bumped 7 times. So you have a bunch of orders sitting there, and then literally nothing happens for 4 months. And then 5 orders go at once. Of course, it messes with cash flow. It makes planning incredibly difficult. And of course, cash flow funds production. And apparently the same in the US, same in the UK. They have, I think, more troubles than we do because they've got the truck driver issue and the Brexit issue. So I wonder what from this some innovation will come.
How much has that raised the price of moving wine out of the country?
Approximately 400%. Some people say more. So it is horrendous. You know, one has to work with one's partners to absorb the cost because it can't only be put on one or the other. So I think we're all taking a lot of pain at the moment for hopefully a better future. Online has been the saving grace, especially in COVID for smaller brands. This year it's been amazing.
COVID wasn't the only threat to the wine trade this decade. Using tariffs on wine to punish rivals is not uncommon. China hit Australian wines with a 220% tariff in 2020 in retaliation for not towing the party line, a point confirmed by Chinese Foreign Ministry spokesman Zhao Lijian in July 2021. What it's meant is a hasty reorganisation of Australian wine exports into new and existing markets. In 2019, a quarter of the country's wine went to China. US President Trump did the same to France in 2019, as did Russia to Georgian and Moldovan wine in 2006.
The thing that is happening to Australia and China is, I mean, this is scary, because if you're a big company and you have your big market, you think everything is fine, and then one day, pop, you're pushed off the market. So what they do, some of them, like Penfolds, the most legendary company from Australia, they made Penfolds Grange, which was the first, they say, Grand Cru of New World. So what they did was some wines that were selling to China, they decided to leave the brand, but make the wine in South Africa. So they would put Shiraz, was the same brand, but it's coming from South Africa, and they still sell it to China. So they're trying to find their ways not to destroy the brand, which is Australian, but to sell the wine. But it's really, really complicated. In the 90s and beginning of 2000s, the whole movement was to lower the tariffs and to make the trade as free as possible. But we can see in the last 10 years, maybe starting with the Trump administration, that it was coming back. EU was giving subsidies to Airbus. It was a long dispute. And in the end of the day, United States decided to put tariffs on France, Germany, Spain, and UK, and they put it on some products and on wine. And some countries, as China, uses tariffs in diplomatic wars For example, Russia banned Georgian wines. Russia banned Moldovan wine, saying there was some chemical compound found them. They were not okay to drink them, which I don't think it was true. Georgia was mostly focused on the export to Russia. They just lost the biggest market. They tried to go to European markets, and they got a response like, sorry, your quality is not there. So they really needed to invest in the quality and reshape, rethink the industry. And actually, that was what helped Georgian wine industry to get to the level of where they are now.
And amongst the diplomatic spats and the fallout of COVID is a more insidious threat to the global wine trade: climate change. Cool weather-loving white wines and notoriously fickle Pinot Noir are at risk as temperatures rise. Climate change is bringing harvesting seasons forward, changing what vines can be planted where, and introducing once unknown diseases to new areas. It's bringing harsher and earlier frosts and hail, which damage young buds. And more regular fires are destroying entire vineyards, and the smoke taints grape flavour. Winemakers in Bordeaux and other places are resorting to desperate measures, trying to fight frost by lighting fires in vineyards and flying helicopters over vines all night long. I asked Ilya what changes he's seeing in Europe.
It's getting less and less predictable. Talk to winemakers and they will tell you climate is changing. Regular alcohol level was 12, 12.5, 13 was a really good. Right now you can find some red wines which are going to be 15.5 or 16 even. Before it was impossible. Why? Because of the wines are getting more heat from the sun, so the sugar levels are higher, and that's just a fact.
Flavour profiles are also changing because hotter days means winemakers must manage the canopy, the leaves around the grapes, differently. Erica says a more open canopy changes the final flavour of the wine. The extra heat in the air is also noticeable at harvest time.
In my life, I've seen some 23 vintages. So it's a long time. And, you know, it used to be really cold at vintage time. We used to rug up and you had gloves and you had beanies and the whole nine yards. We used to pick the early varietals in the early part of April. So Pinot Gris, Pinot Noir, Chardonnay, even a little bit before that. And then Sauvignon Blanc, all those naturally slotted in behind that, middle April and later, into May from time to time. We've not picked Sauvignon Blanc in April since 2016. This year, we picked Pinot Noir and Pinot Gris same time, if not after Sauvignon Blanc. It was the shortest vintage we've ever done. It puts enormous pressure on production facilities. So, for instance, we used to work on 6 weeks, now we work on two. So it's had that sort of capital investment implications as more and more companies are looking to put their own facilities in. But with that, of course, comes effluent management, and there's a capacity for that in Marlborough. So it's not as easy as one thinks that you can just build another winery or another crush pad. You know, it all has to do with the whole circular thing of effluent management. It is going to be an increasingly difficult part of our lives. We need to look at New Zealand in perspective. It's very temperate. The average temperature in Marlborough in summer is 24. I think we've got a few years up our sleeve to supply the style that people are used to. And the cool climate style of wine that we have here, of course, is so acid dependent. But, you know, people's palates evolve as well. And we already see with Pinot, with Sauvignon Blanc, for instance, that people are evolving away from the big green aromatics that come at you, sort of looking for something a little bit more sophisticated and other flavors. And, you know, as the industry evolves and as wine drinkers evolve, people are going to look for new iterations of, I mean, we can see it in Australia, what's happened to Chardonnay, what's happened to some of the reds. They've pulled back on the oak.
That kind of innovative thinking is happening in Europe too, where Champagne and Germany are beginning to produce vintages rather than blends, once thought impossible because it was too cold for grapes to ripen on the vine. And in possibly the biggest surprise for the wine world, some champagne houses are buying land in England as they see potential for English sparkling wine. But for hot places like Italy, Spain, and Australia, scarce water resources will be needed for irrigation to maintain younger vineyards. Northern Hemisphere winemakers are now eyeing once ignored north-facing slopes in order to get less sun and higher elevations. And down south, Tasmania, the chilly isle at the foot of Australia, and Invercargill, which is even further south at the bottom of New Zealand, are now being spoken of as the next wine regions. Winemakers are changing their practices to mitigate climate change and the perception of their part in it. New Zealand has encouraged sustainable practices for decades, but with water becoming a hot-button topic, thirsty locations like Marlborough and the Hawke's Bay are having to rethink how they grow vines.
Equipment is becoming a lot more sophisticated, and they're looking at smaller tractors and all those things. But the biggest contributor in the carbon footprint of a bottle of wine is, of course, packaging and bottle. Packaging, bottle and freight, it's about 47% to 56% of a bottle of wine. We at Loveblock have just changed to a lighter bottle. So we're really all looking at our whole processes and see where can we cut the carbon emissions. Because bottle weight has a lot to do with the perception of quality in wine. So we had ours, I guess, in a medium size weight, a 550 weighing 550 grams a bottle, which is quite a lot. And changing to a 417 takes 1.6 kilograms off a case of wine of 12. But with just that one change, we shave 15% off our carbon footprint.
Having a strong sustainability reputation will become increasingly important for wine producers as the next generation of drinkers, Gen Z, demands action.
Gen Z particularly are an interesting mob because their alcohol consumption is definitely down and they do look for ethical brands. And they're also savvy, you know, you can't greenwash or tell stories. But what we also see is the rise of the conscious consumer, especially in the times of COVID, you know, because what we used to wear used to say something about our status. Now the brands and the things that we consume says more about your values than about your status. So the most important thing for the wine trade is how do we connect with that consumer and tell our story?
Changing consumerism is leading to altered habits. We are seeing the rise of wine in cans, just like premixed drinks or beer, and apps that recommend wine using algorithms based on your previous purchases, taking the guesswork out of trying new wines. Changes of perceptions and tastes are an opportunity for companies and countries. Sherry, for example, was perceived as a wine grandmothers drank. Today, sherry makers are producing a new kind of wine that is unfortified, defying traditional customers and stereotypes.
I was quite shocked because Spain is quite traditional. Sherry, to be the oldest wine region in Europe, almost, it's one of the most innovative. So there is a room for innovation everywhere. Without innovation, you will die as an industry. And from there, we'll find maybe many answers for the climate change or for the changing consumer behavior, or how to communicate with younger consumers. That's why you can see more wines without alcohol, which for me sounds like, what is that? It doesn't taste like wine. No, but it's growing. And that's the future.
The earliest evidence of wine drinking was noted some 8,000 years ago. Today, wine is still as popular a tipple as it has ever been. The drink has survived war, pestilence, disease, and today, producers are even finding a way to fend off teetotalism. But as with all agricultural industries, wine is not and never has been an easy trade. Climate change is threatening the viability of famous wine regions, while wine's eternal popularity makes it vulnerable to state-level persecution, let alone what impact the new eye-watering cost of getting wine to the end drinker will have down the track. And yet, despite wine's reputation for tradition, innovation is never far away, and it is this drive to push for change that will continue to secure the future of our favourite drink. I'm Rachel Williamson, and you've been listening to Trading Places.